I had the opportunity to meet him some months ago when we were invited to visit his hospital, which is one of the few ones that has reached MRON 7 classification from him. And I found it particularly regarding, it's not directly linked to openness, but I found very interesting to learn about the human factor and how a CIO evaluates a particular HR system for the adoption. So I think it's going to be really good feedback for open implementer to have this overview on a CIO mind that has undergone this complex process. So please welcome Telmo.
First of all, I want to thank the EHR for inviting me to explain a history of implementation of EMR in the last 12 years, because this history started in 2008. And as you will see, it's a hard and long history of perhaps some success in terms of implementation. For that reason, I'm going to try to explain in only 30 minutes something that I use 3 hours. For that reason, I'm going to explain and to speak perhaps quickly. And the final, if you have any question, please stop me and we can discuss or after the presentation. The target or the objective of this presentation is to explain some details about the Marina Salud project, that is an hospital that we are based 90 kilometers in the south of Valencia, in the Mediterranean coast in Denia. I'm going to explain how we move from solutions, from a vision of implementing solutions, to a vision of implementing processes in the hospital, and some of the challenges that we have in the hospital and that I want to share with you. Some special information about the hospital, because we are a public hospital but with a private management, and that makes easier for us the IT guys, because we avoid some of the bureaucratic processes that we have in the public sector. Because previously I was working in the regional government as in IT. It was really complex to go fast with the implementation of technology, making the agreements with the companies. And in the private sector, all this it's easier. Some of the characteristics of our organization is that we have a 15 years contract with the government, and we receive a fixed amount of money for each of the population of our area, that more or less is about 154,000 people. In the project, we had to build a new hospital. And you can imagine, we opened the hospital in 2009, we built a new hospital, we opened with a new EMR in the hospital, and perhaps 50% of the staff was new. And it's easier to change to a EMR from paper EMR to paperless if you have all this new organization. We are also ACO like the Americans, because one of our shareholders is an insurance company, and if you receive a fixed amount of money for each people of your region, the only way to gain some money is to maintain the population healthy. And that's one of the interesting characteristics, because the financial model is not to do a lot of interventions, a lot of consultations, and have a lot of patients in the hospital. The model is to have the patients in primary care, or having the patients in at home, because it's cheaper for us. About the IT system, I started in the company at the final of 2006, and we had to select IT system that had to improve the care of the patient, of course, and complete with all the requirements. We have a set of more than 800 questions for the different providers that we had in the Spanish market in that epoch. the final of this process was a complex process, more than 1 year. Turner was the finalist of this process. Turner is an American provider of electronic medical record, and at that moment we had a big challenge because with the contract with the government we only had 14 months for implementing the EMR. And some characteristic of the project. We have attitude and commitment. It was the first implementation in Spain of this EMR. It was the first implementation in Spanish. They didn't have in that moment some experience because they are American about the public healthcare system in Europe. This kind of waiting list for something malaria that was not a standard functionality of the IT system. And that was a set of problems that we had to manage in that moment. The system map that we selected was Turner Millennium for all the healthcare of the hospital. We managed with only one system the surgical area, the emergency department, the ward, the oncology department. Everything is managed by the same IT system, by the same EMR. And that was important for us because we are a little hospital. We have about 209 beds. And with this budget, you cannot manage a huge IT department. And for us, it was simple to have, more simple if you have a unique system because you don't have to create a lot of integration between the different departmental, because that was the previous experience that I had in other hospitals of having the best of three solutions with one specific solution for the ICU, another solution for oncology department, another for the nurses, and a lot of integration between them. And that was really complex in the hospitals that I was working previously. That was one of the criteria that we selected Turner Millennium. And on the other hand, we had the same decision, Oracle, Business Suite, and PeopleSoft for managing all the financial and all the human resourcing processes. And with the same philosophy, these two systems are systems based on the parameterization. You can evolve the system, you can create pathways or clinical pathways without any programming, without technical people or engineers involved on. We have in the IT department, we have nurses, we have a pharmacist, we have people from radiology area, etc. We also have engineers for some integrations that I will explain now. More characteristics of the project. As I said, we moved from an old hospital to a new organization. We only had 14 months with a methodology that was part of the methodology of the provider that we defined as a fast and furious because we had a clear steps in the process, a clear points where the methodology. Where we had to take a lot of decisions in this process, in the design. We have to take a lot of decisions after the integration test. And one of the problems that we had during the implementation was that we didn't have experience implementing this American system. And you can imagine a solution that you can parameterize and the same code runs in a Spanish hospital and the same code is running in Middle East, in a pediatric hospital, and it's running in US. You can build a different kind of hospitals. And if you don't have the experience of taking that decision because you don't know the consequence of your decision, that create a bad environment for the process. On the other side, it was the first implementation on non-English language from Turner. One of the problems that we have here in Spain, in most in other people is that we don't have good skills in the English language, and we ask to the provider to have engineers speaking Spanish with us, and that theory, and that makes that they had to contract new people for this project without experience. And you can imagine the meetings, the people from Marina School, people from the provider, the Spanish people, that they didn't have experience, and the real good engineers from US. And we asking something to the Spanish people, they translate it to them, and when it comes, the answer it was terrible. And that was an error for our part, to ask to the provider for having some the interlocution with Spanish people. And some specific details about the project. In Ferner, they were a small team, new, but they were very committed, because you can imagine young people in an amazing project of where the target was being a paperless environment from the day one. That was the target. How we can parameterize this solution for avoiding any paper in all the clinical processes. As I explained it, architects, but they didn't speak Spanish. And in Marina Salud, we had also a small team, a new team that we contracted for the project. And we had a lot of pressure, because we had the date of the opening the hospital. And on the other side, it was complex, because we were moving from a public hospital to a private managed hospital. And you can imagine that part of the staff of the old hospital, public managed, had to come to work with us in the private. And that adds a lot of complexity to the process. You can imagine the kind of problems that we had with the unions, because we had to train the people from the old hospital, but they were public servants. We couldn't train them during the morning, because they were working in the public hospital, and we tried to train them during the afternoon, but we couldn't, because as a private company, we couldn't pay to a public servant. And you can imagine the kind of things that we had to do for training people. Some of the people started to train the day of the go-live, and they started to work in the hospital with a technician on their side, and it was crazy. Another problem that we had, as you can imagine, is and more in the part of the doctors, because part of the doctors were working in the old hospital. You can imagine, they have a lot of responsibility. The head of the surgical area, they had to design how they meet the processes and how they meet the clinical documentation in the electronic medical record. But he also had to define all the materials from the surgical area, and they had to design how to move all the patients from the waiting list to the new waiting list in the hospital. And the same with the pharmacy, and the same with all the services. As always, the IT is in the second place of the priorities. And that had some consequences that I am going to explain you. About the methodology implementation, the method M that I explained to you in the picture, and some other problems. I'm going to explain a lot of problems that I think that we have to learn about the problems. The first problem that we had was in the prescription process. Another sentence, when you add a medication in a EMR, it's not only adding the medication and having the form of the doctor prescribe and select all the details of the prescription, like the doses, the time, etc. If you do that, it's an amount of bureaucracy for them. You need to create an order center. For some medication, there are 80% of the prescription is based on 5 different models. And you have to create these order centers for them. And we didn't have enough order sentences. And this created a problem. This adds some complexity to the process of prescription. Another problem was that we moved from brand name medication to a generic name. And they didn't have experience with the generic names of the medication, but that was a good decision. Another problem that we have with the laboratory test, because the head of the laboratory that worked with us in the implementation, they created the catalog, and the catalog was based on scientific names of the lab test that were not the common names that the doctor used. And that adds some complexity to the decision process. And we adapt the flow or the way that we ask the radiology test in paper, and we move that flow to the IDR. That was another error because we don't use all the facilities that the IT can adapt to us. Some more problems. We have a really complex design stage. The validation, you can imagine the validation without finish the hospital. We had to make the validation of the system in a lab. And there was the second integration test when we had to test the printers and all the processes inside the hospital with all the building staff working and cleaning the hospital, etc. It was really complex. Training. As I explained it, how we can train people when they are not available. And another problem that we had with doctors, not with nurses, was that the training was managed by doctors that participated in the implementation. And they created the big book of the EMR and all the things that a doctor can do with an EMR. That's impossible. That's impossible. Because there are so many ways for doing the same thing that creates a lot of confusion with the doctors. We changed that strategy when we started the hospital, and we trained the doctors one by one, and we explained not all the things that they can do, we explained the workflows that they have to do depending on they are working in that moment, and that's another thing. Big Bang Go Live. In our experiences, we knew that if you start with paper with the hospital, it's really complex to move from to eliminate that paper and put a process. We started with a big bang without any paper at the first moment. And you can imagine all processes without any paper, without administrative staff. In the old hospital, the doctors had a nurse inside the office, in the ambulatory area. In the new hospital, they only had a computer with electronic medical records. That was a real crisis at the beginning. What happened after the go-live? The nurses team that designed the EMR did a real good job. In fact, 12 years after, the nursing processes are the same. 80% of the nursing processes are the same. But we had a lot of problems with the medical processes because they design the same processes that they had in paper and move the processes to the EMR, and that was a fatal error. Also, we have some errors in the design of Millennium as a consequence of the lack of our experience in that, and a lot of complaints of the staff. One of the things that we create in that moment is this classical team of super users distributed in the hospital. But you can imagine to open the hospital with a lot of incidents, the super users that they started to manage this anxiety with the people and to try to help them, but at one moment the super user start to abandon the project because we didn't have some kind of model of compensation to them. It was like a boon that if you participate in the presentation, you have that, for example. The turning point, it is right here. What we did in 2010, we started in 2009, and in 2010, we take some decision, some really important decision. First was to create a customer service that is this, a first level with a call center and people that only they are only working with they are working in the phone or via email or nowadays in some forms via web, and they are helping people from all the incidents or questions that they have for with the IT system. They are also responsible for the user training, and we cover this call center between 7 o'clock in the morning and 11 in the afternoon. And with that, the consequence is that the development team, that is the second level, started to work on it, solving problems and making some changes and new developments on the IT system. And with that, we achieve a lot of time for the development team, because the customer service at the final of 2010, 90% of the incidents that arrived from the customer service were solved in the customer service level. And that was really important thing. And on the other side, we created the clinical transformation office that was an office that based on 5 doctors, internal medicine, emergency department, primary care, a surgical area, and one doctor from hospitalization, that they work one day per week, working with receiving from the middle management, the steering committee, all the change requests that people propose. They analyze this and discuss with them, and they send to the second level all these requests, prepared for the development, and discuss it with the end users. And that was really important, because that was the turning point. The EMR go through an IT project to a clinical project, because the leadership of the EMR project was based on the clinical transformation office, and they were clinical people. This is my friends that started to go well. 2011, we started to focus on processes. Thanks to the improvements in the clinical transformation office, the call center, and development teams, and one of the consequences was to achieve the HIMSS stage 6. And the HIMSS stage 6 was a call that we received from Germany, and it's a kind of evaluation that is non-profit organization make and evaluate from 0 to 7, and we achieve the level 6, that is the previous to 7, that is the top. And the things that they told to us that were really interesting was that all the physician documentation and the closed loop medication process, that was interesting, because the physical adoption, we have a 100% adoption in nurses and physicians, but it was easy for us because there was no way for not adopting the system. But it's not the same if you are moving from a paper in a hospital. That, and this is another interesting thing, because we implemented some alerts that the provider sent to you, some alerts like the sepsis detection protocol. But what happens is that in the culture of the American people or American hospitals, they use different lab tests, they use different parameters for creating these algorithms. And we had to adapt that algorithms to our clinical culture. And that was one of the things that people from HIMSS explaining to us, that was a good job, and demonstrate some benefits of the implementation. But one of the interesting things was that they told us that we were really near to achieving the HIMSS stage 7, because we had to improve in business intelligence and dashboards, and a lot of it in creating this dashboard for the steering committee, but also for the clinical staff. And 1 year after, in 2012, we achieved the HIMSS stage 7. These are some of the characteristics, because we had the enterprise data warehouse, and that was also important because you can imagine a paperless environment in a hospital. What happens when you have a downtime? It's crazy because you lose everything. You don't know the names of the patients, the medication, what kind of pathology, what is the next time that you have. You don't know anything. That's a real crisis. And we implemented in 2011 a process for the downtime when we have downtimes. It's a process of a local copy of the EMR in different places of the hospital where the doctors can consult if we have this process. Some consequences or some projects that we had in 2012 was a pathway for the early diagnosis of cervical cancer. Another interesting thing was the automatic shipping of discharge records to primary care. I need to explain something with that because that was the first time that we did something for the patients, because previously the patients, when we discharge a patient in emergency department or on the ward, the patient take the discharge report and go to the primary care and show and take an appointment in primary care doctor and give to them and start the process in primary care. What we did with the discipline is that the primary care doctor and nurse receive automatically at the same moment that we did the discharge this report. And that was fantastic for them because most of the times they receive a call from primary care before to arriving at home, that don't worry, I'm your nurse, I'm going to tomorrow morning to take care of your hand, or I'm your doctor, don't worry, take the medication, I'm renewing the receipt, and you can came in 2 days, and that's not a problem. Another thing is we have 100% of the patient with nursing care plans, that the nurses are fantastic working with the EMR, and Multum. Multum is the database that we use for the medication, for the allergies, for interactions, for checking the dose of the medication. And 37, in a study of 2012, the physician modified the prescription when we activate the Multum system. These are some other benefits from the implementation that and outcomes that we explained to him. But what means stage 7? Stage 7, in our opinion, don't mean that you finish the process. If you are in the stage 7, you did everything. No, stage 7 means that you have all the pieces of the level codes for creating the kind of hospital that you need. And you can modify easily this hospital. And let me give only three or four minutes explaining some details about what means for us being a stage 7. If you know HIMSS stage scale, we believe that EMR have to be smart. That's one of the targets of implementing electronic medical record. They have to help to the doctor. And if you analyze the HIMSS scale, the clinical decision support system start in stage 2 and move from the final in stage 7 with the business intelligence or with the closed room medication administration in stage 6. In stage 6, they also ask for clinical decision systems taking into account some health parameters of the patients and some lab results and how you create these complex algorithms. For that reason, I think that one of the benefits of the implement for the doctors of implementing an EMR in the hospital is that are the clinical decision support system. In fact, one of the best impacts that we had in the hospital was when we activate in the prescription process, in the medication process, when we activate the allergies, interactions, and checking those, was the first time that the doctor felt that the system were helping them in their process. And that's one of the things that we had to invest a lot. Clinical workflows, guided. The EMR has to guide the doctors. That's really important because we need to invest a lot in usability. We cannot create complex forms for only thinking about taking structured data. We need to do that in a way that is easy for them. If not, they are not going to do. And they are not going to adopt that. You are implementing a lot of forms and nobody is doing them. We need to add quality and safety. And for that, in our experience, the clinical workflows, it's of course adding information to the process, but had to add some other parts of the process, like the consents. The consent is a part of the workflow, of the clinical workflow, and has to be integrated in the medical record. And appointments, that's always a problem in our hospital, but the appointment is a part of the talk between the doctor and it's a part of the care process. Because I am a doctor and I want to see you in 3 months. Come and see me that Wednesday at 11. And that has to be a part of the process. Or, for instance, the orders or the reports. No? And everything has to be in a way, in the clinical workflow and in a usability way. Pathology protocols. We have to define standard processes. A problem that we have, and it's one of the conclusions that we I will share with you, is that these pathology protocols, what happened in our hospitals when we are not big or huge hospitals with a lot of staff, is that you can engage some people for creating some protocol from some specific pathology. But you have to review that protocol every year because all of this knowledge evolves and we cannot maintain that. We don't have enough people or staff or clinical staff for maintaining all that information. And of course, the best decision, no? And for that reason, we have protocols. The protocols have to contain medication, the kind of care, some tests that we need, and patient information. We have to involve the patient on that. Patient management. As a ACO, we have to, the standard EMR always take into account the individual patient. But we had to, we started to work with groups of patients. We started to work with some specific patients with chronic disease or cancer screening or post-surgical patients for managing their care as a group and having this nurse that manage them. And in this patient management, we have to take into account and introduce the medication, test, information, the control of the face on where the patient is in that moment. And this is another important thing that we had a good discussion previously in the coffee. What we always do in terms of dashboards is always starting making the dashboard for the general manager or for the financial guys of the hospital. And that is a fatal error. We have to start the dashboard with the doctors. If we implement a process, we have to create in parallel the dashboard because it's the way for giving this feedback to them. We have to give them the feedback because with that we engage them and we increment the usability of the system. And we have to create from activity, from quality, from financials, and from health results. That it's more complex than if we compare with activity. Some conclusions. Am I finishing? We have to decide. If we want to evolve, if we want to evolve in our healthcare, or we want to implement a revolution, because what is happening is all the IT outside healthcare, it's going really, really fast. And in shelter, we are going as slow as always. And for that, we need a lot of investment that we don't, almost in Spain, we don't have enough investment for taking some speed in implementation on new IT in the hospital. And this is another thing that I think that it's a cultural problem that we have. We don't pay for content, almost in little hospitals, but it's necessary because we cannot have this team of doctors creating the clinical pathways and maintaining these clinical pathways inside. Perhaps we have to build this content to some companies that are focused on that, and they are selling that content, and we have to only review that content and put in that content in these clinical pathways. Okay, that's all. Thank you very much. If you have any questions.
Okay. Any questions? Maybe we have time for one, two questions. They are fast. Thank you, Christian.
I just speak up.
Thank you, Izan, for a very interesting presentation. From experience, you often see that one of the major inhibitors for your return on investment is you gradually have to reduce the scope of the project, either due to a schedule you have to meet or constraints of resources. Was this one of the challenges you saw, that you started out with a larger scope than what you were able to finally produce?
Well, as I said, the scope or the target of the project was quite easy. Paperless environment day one. I'm making it easy. I can put an example. We are involved right now in the upgrade of the system. We are implementing every 5 years, we upgrade all the data center and upgrade the EMR and all the other systems that we have in the hospital. But what is the scope of this upgrade and the other upgrade that we did in 2012? Is making an upgrade for changing anything. Because the project starts after the upgrade. Because we have 4 years after the upgrade until the next upgrade for giving to the people all the improvements that the new technology gives to us, the IT team. What is doing my team right now, the development team, the nurses and engineers working? We started this project of upgrade 6 months ago, but they don't have any work to do right now. But what they are doing, they are studying all the new functionality that we will have, and they are thinking what kind of innovation we can achieve with the new technology that we are implementing next year in March. Because with that, we are creating the path of implementing new functionality. In a way of innovation and thinking about functionality that people is going to use.
Okay, I think we are stressing to get further, but one short question. You talked about at one point the clinicians got the decision or the process support, or they saw what the system could give them of process support. Mm-hmm. How, if you draw a timeline to that, how many years did you work before they actually...
They started to work with processes. It was part of the, it was one of the consequences of the clinical transformation office. Because what happens in a hospital like us that it's paperless and it's based on a electronic medical record is that if you try to change a simple thing, you can imagine a cardiologist asks for a new test or a new intervention. That's not only adding a new test in the catalog. It's adding a new process. And the clinical transformation office was the beginning of that way of thinking. Because sometimes you have the a multiplier that if you are changing something little here and it's making some changes in other areas. But about the question, it was part of the responsibility of the clinical transformation office. And another, how many times we need for making a clinical pathway, implementing a clinical pathway, it depends of the complexity. But we have some measures. 80% of the time, it's in the design, and 20% in the implementation. But you have to involve the clinical staff and having all these discussions. And
okay. So, thank you very much, Bizan, for this interesting presentation.